Okay, so Tylzen just recommended a YouTuber named Republicofsandles. When people make recommendations, they'll scan one or two videos to see if they look like someone I might be interested in. He seems to be a very liberal Christian, and I watched a video called Dear Scientific Atheists. Most of the video is him using his understanding of theoretical physics to try and prove that the hypothesis for God is just as probable and believable as most theoretical physics. Sadly, straight off the bat, he shows that his understanding of theoretical physics is completely wrong, as well as how theoretical physicists view physics. Now, one of Sagan's rules of skepticism that I've repeated many times on this channel and I hold very deeply as important is do not go beyond your own area of expertise. So I will present my credentials, which is a background in naval nuclear engineering, which covers non-calculus-based particle physics and classical physics. Also, I had a calculus-based physics 1 and 2 in college and took modern physics, but I had to drop it as my calculus kung fu is very weak. Since then, I've been a hobby amateur physicist and have kept up on the latest discoveries in physics. Sadly, as theoretical physics is such a confusing and misunderstood subject by the general public, it has many times been confused and misrepresented. Mystics who want to sell books like Deepak Chopra especially will take people's ignorance of physics and abuse it to mean what they want it to mean. Republic of Sandals, I have to say that you're asking good questions and using your brain, but you're using very flawed understandings of the topic. Before I realized it, I had written five comments in your comment section, and I'm hoping I didn't come off as a complete dick. As this is probably an area confused by many people, I figured making a response video was in order instead of just filling up your comment section. First off, you say that you're unaware of evidence that convinces you of the existence of black holes. Certain points of astronomy are not something I'm familiar with, at least backing up our evidence for, but there is a very good video by Ignorant Fool showing evidence and explaining why black holes do have evidence for their existence. Next, you go on to discuss antimatter. Antimatter has been synthesized, especially in CERN, and there are plans to attempt to make plants to ramp up production of antimatter in relatively large amounts, but still very small for safety concerns, of course. You show your lack of understanding of how physicists come up with their ideas and treat the ideas as just creative, just like your religion. Theoretical physics works on mountains of evidence and math. They have been given very good reasons to think that it may be the correct method. From there, they gain a new working model, and they can now set about to prove or disprove it using methods never thought of before. They collect brand new data, and usually a lot of it proves the current theory as not correct, because we're still in early stages. But some of the model usually is. They have now eliminated another hypothesis. The lens is now more refined, and they can come up with new models and new experiments based on this new data from this new experiment that they never would have thought of without the previous model being created. As you stated, antimatter goes against all previously known ideas of existence, but evidence shows it exists, so we have to change our ideas of reality. Antimatter does not have anti-gravity. I don't know where you got this idea. Just to clarify, charge and gravity are two completely different forces. I could be wrong, and you may have new evidence that antimatter also has anti-gravity and not just opposite charge. If you do, please let me know. Proton-negatron or electron-positron annihilation takes these two charges and converts them into light energy, eliminating the mass completely, E equals mc squared. Your understanding of theoretical physics is flawed on very basic levels, but at least you're trying. No one has faith in string theory. You say they believe, but in theoretical physics, when they say the word believe, they're making it very vague and fluid because they know that there's always going to be something else that could possibly show up. It's not like your religious belief where you have faith, which is a belief without evidence. These people have strong evidence, and therefore they believe. As soon as the evidence changes, they stop believing. Actually, the current model that is now testable is a hybrid of five different versions of string theory, now called M theory, One of the reasons CERN was built was to test some of the assertions by M theory, and if their assertions prove false or they find new evidence, it's back to the drawing board in terms of math and theory, but they have new data to work with. A rule in quantum physics is if you claim to get quantum physics, then you don't get quantum physics. You discuss the fact that M theory, or I think you use string theory, electrical waves have similar properties to brain waves and neural connections. No one is saying that there is a universal consciousness. It's a nice possibility, scientists say, but they have no real idea or evidence. Mystics like Deepak Chopra, however, will claim it to be real. If M theory is proven correct, then the probability of alternate universes is raised significantly because the math backs it up. But they will always say we can never know, even if they work on that model to run experiments to make the next breakthrough that changes their discoveries. You said that gravity is not 100% true. Actually, the theory of gravity is 100% true on our scale. Once things get bigger or smaller, then the scale we evolved on stops working. We now must come up with new ideas as to why and how it works on other scales, which is what astrophysics and quantum physics is. Testing on these scales is very difficult and very expensive. You also very much misunderstood the discussion that gravity is not guaranteed. The first rule I learned in chemistry is there is an exception to every rule. The Zeroth law of thermodynamics is that if two systems are in thermal equilibrium with a third system, they are also in thermal equilibrium with each other. Equilibrium means that the system is not exchanging heat or energy. This means that if you take two systems and one is higher in temperature than the other, the system will exchange heat until it comes into equilibrium. However, temperature is the measurement of the average macroscopic kinetic energy of a substance, so anything that has heat is moving or vibrating. And by vibrating, I mean the atom is constantly exchanging energy with the atoms around it, much like an elaborate, never-ending pool game. Heat will flow from the higher system by the Zeroth law to a system of lower energy if allowed to do so. That is a law. However, because the never-ending pool game, it's not guaranteed that it will always happen. Sometimes, due to a strange quirk of physics, heat for a very short period of time can actually flow from a lower to a higher. Very short, we're talking nanoseconds. However, to observe this reaction, you would have to observe this experiment going on a near infinite amount of times. By statistics of the size of the universe, this reaction is happening constantly somewhere in the universe at some point in time, but it's completely unobservable and ridiculously too near improbable of a chance that you will ever observe it. So the chances of occurring in your experiments in all of your lifetime are not even taken into consideration. If it was to occur, your statistical analysis of the experimental data would account for the outliers, if you were any form of a good scientist. The same is true with gravity. We don't have a 100% guarantee that it will always work, but all observed experimentation has shown to work 99.9 to the near infinity percent of the time in this scope. Philosophically, we can't assume that gravity will happen the next time, but in terms of understanding and getting by in this reality, we're going to have to go by the most probable, especially if it's so extreme, as opposed to the extremely tiny chance of what might be with no evidence. Cryptozoology is generally not considered a real science. However, there is a branch for species considered extinct that's considered somewhat legit. However, sadly, it is made up of mostly amateur non-scientists because science doesn't have the funding to do a large enough sweep of an entire area to be certain. Ben Radford is a good skeptic, ghost hunter, and cryptozoologist who debunked one of the Nessie photographs and has debunked several Bigfoot claims. As for coelacanth, no one assumed it never existed. We had fossil evidence that it once existed. No cryptozoology group was looking for the coelacanth. It just so happened to be discovered by a museum curator when analyzed a fishing catch. Cryptozoologists tend to go after the sensational. Coelacanth was not a sensation. There was nothing exciting about it, except to the scientific community who thought for certain it was probably extinct. The closest cryptozoologists have to real science are the ones who hunt the recently extinct species, such as the ivory-billed woodpecker or the thylacine Tasmanian tiger. Almost all evidence for these cryptozoologists have been found by either scientists or skeptics to be faked or confused due to poor methodology. If you ever come across a cryptozoologist who actually acts like a scientist and is severely skeptical of their own claims, you might actually see the scientific community give them some respect. Science is completely agnostic and bases everything on probability of something as opposed to certainty. And it's understandable that you're agnostic of your God, however, your God still requires faith. There are very few atheists who say there is definitely no God, like you seem to claim. Just like science, most atheists are agnostic, which runs on probabilities. If there's very low probability for a deity and no evidence, then there's no reason to believe in it till further evidence shows. That's true for any hypothesis.